Welcome to another video in the series about the C7000 compiler. This video is an overview of the C7000 DSP architecture. My name is George Mock, and I'm your guide. The video opens with the C7000 data path block diagram. Now, there's a lot to see here, there's a lot going on, and by this way, this doesn't represent every single detail of the data path, just sort of the main ones worth talking about as an introduction. So there's just a few things that I want to point out to you for the moment, and we will come back to this diagram later after we've fleshed some of these concepts out. So there's an A side and a B side, okay? The A side is what we call scalar size, which is to say it's built in with operations that it works on at 64 bits. Now, I can do operations smaller than 64 bits, but 64 bits is sort of like the natural width of the A side. The B side, by contrast, is what we call vector width. And I'll be talking about what vector width means a bit more in a few slides. But vector width is wider than 64 bits, and just what a vector is and so on. Well, we will get to that. But that all happens on the B side. Other thing I want to point out is all these units running around on both sides. A more specific term for them is functional units. If you think of a single functional unit as like a very limited form of a CPU, that's not perfectly right, but it's a good way to think of it as a start. And there's, you know, several of these on both sides. I also want you to notice how there are global registers that sort of everybody on this side can communicate with. And there's a set of global registers on both sides, you know, scalar size and vector width size. But there are also local registers, okay, on both sides. Please consider another diagram. This one is of a C6000, because what we're going to show here is how C6000, the predecessor to C7000, evolves into C7000. This is particularly good for those of you who know C6000. If you don't, it's fine. There's still a lot of architecture concepts that are introduced in this evolution that this is still a good way to learn about them. So on C6000, there's an A side and a B side. And this diagram seems to indicate that they're identical. They're not identical, but they're very similar, okay? Register files and units and so on, concepts that we've seen already. When this is changed into C7000, evolve, I should say, into C7000, the B side becomes what we call vector width size, okay? And a vector width can be either 256 bits, 512 bits, and so on. As of this recording, these are the two choices that are available, but that will change over time. And what we're talking about in a vector is, say, let's go with 256 for an example right now. That means the maximum size of the vector that could be processed by the B side is 256 bits long. Within that vector, you can have elements of, you know, 8 bits, 16 bits, 32 bits, that sort of thing, and they come to how many ever a 256-bit vector can hold. Another change is that the M unit is split into two units, the M unit and the N unit, and this means you can have more multiply instructions occurring in parallel because, you know, one on the M unit, one on the N unit. Next, a few things are added. The C unit is new with C7000. It's for vector permutation. This is where you, inside of a vector, elements are moved around. A horizontal add is where you add up all the elements of a vector, yielding a single value. And other operations like that within a vector, that's what happens on the C unit. Notice all these additional register files. Remember on the previous diagram, we talked about global registers and local registers. that's a distinction that does not exist on C6000, where there was just, you know, global registers. We didn't have this concept of local registers in C6000. Streaming engine. So the streaming engine can significantly improve the performance of the memory hierarchy by prefetching data from memory to a location near the DSP. So suppose you've got a loop where there's an operation happening with a really big vector, a 512-bit vector. You need to load this vector from memory over and over again in the loop. The streaming engine is about making that happen as fast as possible. All of the C7000 DSPs available as of this recording have two streaming engines. That pattern is likely to continue for quite some time, but a few years from now, who knows? A few more things get added. LUT stands for lookup table. HAST stands for histogram. These are additional features on the C7000 DSP. There is support for them from the compiler. However, it is not automatic support. That is to say, it's not the case that the compiler will somehow detect a pattern in your code and turn it into instructions related to these features. SA stands for the streaming address generator. The streaming address generator can help limit the number of instructions required to calculate an address used for a load or store instruction. So suppose you have a loop that's going through memory in some interesting way, and it takes a few instructions to compute that interesting way of going through memory. Well, instead of having those instructions inside the loop, what you can do instead is configure an SA before the loop, so that inside the loop you can just say SA advance, and it will do all those interesting operations for you and avoid those instructions inside the loop. And it's always good to do that with our very important loops in the application. There are four streaming address generators on all the C7000 DSPs available as of this recording, and that is likely to continue to be the case for quite some time, but in the a more distant future, who can say? A C7000 is often described as a VLIW machine. That stands for Very Long Instruction Word. But what does this mean? Well, it means you can encode a lot of instructions in parallel. In this specific case, 12 instructions in parallel. You'll do this on the presumption that the compiler will find lots of parallelism when it's building the code. And the main way that happens is by scheduling the loops into a software pipeline. That's why later on in this video series, we have multiple videos planned on the topic of software pipelining. There are lots of functional units. I've already hinted at them. And one of the, how this relates to VLIW and parallelism is that an instruction for each unit can appear once in a group of instructions that are executing in parallel. Some details on the functional units. There are 13 functional units. And remember, a functional unit is sort of like a CPU that has very limited capability. And this shows you what capabilities each of the functional units has. M and N can do the multiplies. L and S are responsible for addition, bitwise operations like AND and OR. The D units are responsible for loading and storing to memory. The D1, there are two of them, D1 and D2. They can both perform scalar loads and stores. With regard to vector, D1 can do the loads, D2 can do the stores. The C unit, this is new with C7000, is for vector permutation and horizontal adds and other operations inside of a vector. P is for vector predication. This is the ability to operate on only a portion of a vector to, in effect, turn a portion of a vector off. You know, certain elements of the vector, you can turn them off or ignore them. And B is for branches. Vector instructions are the primary way by which the C7000 supplies SIMD capability, where that stands for single instruction, multiple data. What that means is you got a single instruction performing the same operation across many elements of data all at once. It's another level of parallelism, if you will. It's inside an instruction. An example is being able to compute 16 32-bit floating point multiplies in a single instruction. And I've already mentioned that the vector width varies by the DSP. Current examples are 512 bits and 256 bits. This is a table of C7000 DSP variants. The first column is the name of the variant. The second column is the compiler option you use when building for that particular variant. The third column is the vector width. Just like I've been saying, it varies from 512 to 256 bits today. And that's how it works out for these particular variants. And the last column is the MMA variant. There are three different ones. I'll talk about that in a second. This is not all the variants. More variants are planned. MMA stands for the Matrix Multiply Accelerator. As the name implies, it's an accelerator on the device all about making matrix multiply much, much faster. The way most customers take advantage of it is through using the TI Deep Learning Library. And that is because the compiler does not offer automated support for the MMA. It doesn't, you know, find instances of matrix multiply in your code and map it onto the instructions that are appropriate for MMA. As promised, we are back to the diagram that opened this video. I want to talk about some of the elements here now that we understand some of the concepts behind them a little better. Start with the functional units. Notice how there's on the A side, they're all something called M1, N1, and there's all ones. And on the B side, the vector width side, there's something two. Okay. These units do similar operations, but on the A side, they're scalar, and on the B side, they're vector. M1 and N1 both do multiplies. L1 and S2 do additions and bitwise operations and that sort of thing. But let's consider the B unit. It's only on the A side. That's for branches. Okay. Let's consider some that are unique to the B side. The C unit is the one that can do operations inside of a vector, like vector permutation, horizontal add. The P unit is the one that's used for turning on and off parts of a vector, you know, predicating the vector. Okay. Now let's look at the data buses. If it's a light blue data bus like this, it's a 64-bit data bus. As you would expect, this is mostly present on the A side. The dark black data bus, it's a vector width data bus, mostly present on the vector side, B side. But let's consider the D1 and D2 units, which I've been skipping over for now, and let's look at how they're connected. So we talked about how the D1 and D2 units can both load and store scalar sized data. And so you can see these arrows, you know, go both ways. But the dark black arrow only goes one way. That's because only the D1 unit can load from memory, send the data over to the B side for the operation to happen. The operation happens, it comes back to the D2 unit, which stores it back to memory. And the last data bus to talk about is a vector predicate data bus connected to the P unit. And you can see how it's connected to the rest of the C7000 data path. I'll close this video with two references. The first one is to the homepage for the C7000 compiler. This is the full web address. If you think that's too much to type in, I agree with you. In that case, search the internet for C7000 compiler. All the search engines I've tried, the first result that came back was this web address. This is where you can download the compiler, the manual, and more details like that. The second reference is to e2e.ti.com. This is for customer questions on any TI product, including the C7000 compiler. If your question is related to the compiler or a similar tool, it will be answered by me. Thank you for watching this video in this series about the C7000 compiler.